My full name is Etzion Becker from Israel. I'm doing some decoration for the new pilgrim center. These are doors for the lobby and the reception. So behind it, I'm acquainted with Ted Judson, the architect, and he knows I'm doing woodwork for many years for a living. And I'm doing this work for Ted Judson, the architect of Meherabad, for the new PC. These are the entrance doors to the reception and lobby. And Ted Judson knows already for quite some time, so I do woodwork at home in Israel for a living. And each time I come here, I do something for fun, like a frame or helping here and there, whatever is needed. And requested me to add something to the new PC. And that's what was decided. So I'm doing this kind of particular project at this moment for Ted. For the BabaLibrary, of course. I'm doing the general woodwork. When I do general woodwork, there are circumstances that the architects and the customers want to add some lines or beautiful lines or artwork to the project. When I make a living, I make a living for whatever comes. And it is usually not artistic work. But I enjoy doing artistic work when it is needed. So I add this tinge of raw of art to my work. My specialty is usually wooden banisters and staircases, and there often it requires some artwork. It's a long Baba story, which I've told a few times. It happened in 1971. It's after a long story of I don't know if you call it a search, because I was not searching for anything, because I didn't know something was missing quite deeply in my life, and I was looking for something, and eventually, after a couple of years of search, supposedly, I came through spiritual groups that were very rare those days in Israel, early 70s. And the New Age didn't start then. It was quite weird. And actually, I was not a spiritual-minded person. And I didn't know for what I was looking. So I was looking for something in life. And what happened, I bumped into, I would call it, the spiritual movement of anthroposophy of Rudolf Steiner, which derived from theosophy. Theosophy is a new age school of spiritual training inaugurated in the 19th century by Madame Blavatsky, and Rudolf Steiner was one of her successors, I believe. And when I came to the group, I was deeply moved. I felt that I came to some truth, deep truth, internally. Even I didn't read the book and I didn't understand what they were talking about. And one of the groups was trying to help me. I was a young, confused boy and didn't understand a word of what they were talking about. And after 6 months there, this particular gentleman quite seriously suggested one day that there is a woman in Jerusalem I should meet. And I met the woman eventually, after a few days, I believe. And
what was her name?
She was the first Baba lover in Israel. She met Meher Baba in 1956 in Delmonico Hotel. Her name was Ruth Carrie Ben Shammai. She was the daughter of the first president of Orthodox Judaism, or the party of ultra-Orthodox Judaism in Europe before World War II. Her father was, if to compare it, she was the daughter of the Jewish Pope, quote unquote, so called. And she didn't like the narrow stream of Judaism. She was looking for something more universal. Even, of course, Judaism was supposed to do, and the basics of it is universal. Often, we get into feeling more
secured as a closed school, whatever that is. And it's a long story how she came to Baba. I published it for the Baba World in the last Hitler post and on the Baba list, etc. It's in writing these stories. And to make the story short, I walked her into her Baba room, and as soon as I saw Baba picture, I knew that I knew who he is. I knew his spiritual status. I knew that he is the eyes of the heart, automatically, spontaneously, without words. I have no idea till now from where I got to think what the master said about them, like Sai Baba and Upasani and Baba Jan, and I knew, but without words, and I also didn't speak English at that time. Not a word. And that's another long Baba story. Actually, Baba, of course, taught me English, etc., etc. And it was quite overwhelming. It was absolutely shattering and overwhelming experience. Having he gave me presumably a droplet of divine love, something which only he gives. And when you experience it, then you really know it all. There's something that the mind has nothing to do with. And it really overwhelms the mind, and the mind didn't even bother asking questions. The mind only after that was thinking what to do with it. It didn't know exactly what to do with it, of course. And I would keep on wondering around how to contribute, what to do about this. Because when I, as soon as I met Baba, as if I heard inwardly, like what you call still a small voice, that I received something very great, but it's not only for me, but for humanity. So it was kind of big on my little head, and I made no idea what to do about this. And the next step was 7 years later, Carrie is getting sick and old. She contracted some disease which prevented her from working, and she was confined to a wheelchair. But just before that, she practically ordered me to take her to Meherabad again. It was 1979, she brought me here first time to Meherabad, and had this wonderful opportunity of seeing some of the mandali, like RDK and Pendu, as well as others just before they passed away, and Padre. And I still remember the handshake till now. I feel that was very unique and very special. Seeing Mera and Mani, all the people. Of course, as soon as I knew who MeherBaba is, and knew who Mera is, and who the mandali are, everything just came to focus at once. There was no process of, in this case, of long personal pondering or reading books. I was reading books, some were just to have his companionship. But this was something beyond reading books. And he just granted it. I didn't request it. And he actually made it very clear that he can do it to any person. There's nothing special about my individual person as a person. And that's part of his game, his humanity. He just dropped it here and there according to his whim. And there's no human logic behind it. And of course, the whole thing just turned all my life upside down, and in an instant, without any, there was not this possession. It was as if you worked with a psychologist many years to adjust your brain. So it was just turned upside down at once. But then what was to do is how to assimilate and work out the whole issue. And of course, being in Meherabad is my delight. And I'm in Israel. He wants me to be in Israel. He wants me wherever he wants me to be. And glad. What happened in 1980, Carrie transferred the Baba Center to my custody. Well, this is another long, amusing Baba story, as usually with Baba. It's always there's some hilarious anecdotes. The story with myself and Carrie is that I never told her the news, the real status of Meherabad, that he is the highest of the high, the avatar of the age, beloved, etc., etc. I knew all this as soon as I met him. But for whatever reason, I have never told her this for the next 14 years till she passed. Next 14 years or so, till she passed away. And she kept on trying to convince me that Meherabad is the avatar of the age and would come to her home. There were no other people coming to her. So later on, I discovered in her papers that she had a group, maybe a few groups in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, and there were meetings. There were people on the list who were requested to send letters to Baba, and I have the list of the names. I have no idea what happened to them. I never heard about them, never saw them, never met them. When I met her, she was totally isolated. There was nobody seeing her, to my understanding at all. There are a few Baba lovers coming to visit her from abroad, like Max Siebert in Cincinnati, who was doing his studies in Tel Aviv University. I believe once Alan Cohen came to visit, and other Baba lovers. Here and there they would come. Otherwise there was no activity. So the fun of the whole story is that Carrie is trying to convince me all the time that Meherabad is the avatar of the age, and I am, have this kind of thing about myself, I believe, that I usually keep silent. I didn't say anything. She was saying this and I was silent like a sphinx or a statue. I've never told her that I know it. And it was quite, sometimes she was even getting desperate about all this. This young person is coming very often. I was working in Jerusalem. I was on the police force as a radio operator. Radio operator was my military training. And that's all what I knew to do for a living. So I went to work in the police force of Jerusalem and Bethlehem as a radio operator. So I was there in Jerusalem, living and working in Jerusalem. And actually I was raised in a small town north of Tel Aviv, which is in Israel standards, a couple of 2-3 hours drive for this. And in 1979, she just told me I must take her to Meherabad. That was kind of an order, supposedly, which of course I fulfilled. There's a long Baba story before that. I actually was not seeing her because, let's say, she was not an easy person like most of the Baba Mandali. She's being considered as one of the core Mandali, so the least ones. Some did it, and she's one of the 102 and 104. I don't know.
She was on the circle.
She's on the circle of on the her one of the inner circle. She's one of the inner circle, and when we read Lord Meher, Baba gives her a very, very particular attention, and I'm keeping the letters she received from Baba and Mani and Adi, very unique and very special letters. Shows Baba's most particular concern, personal concern for Carrie when she came first to Delmonico Hotel. It's a long Baba story, very interesting. I wrote it in detail, whatsoever we know. These were tough times in Israel, and we lived under rations. And she for summer, manage to get to New York City in the 50s, and the Winterfells were there were Jewish people. Presumably they were associated, and they suggested that there is some spiritual master coming. And she came, and she was just caught by him like a fly to the fire. She really wanted to be consumed by him there and then. There's a good photo of her, of that particular meeting. Anyway, what happened, she was a very fiery and difficult person, very assertive, even domineering. She couldn't understand why the world is not running to Baba's fold. Why come the world doesn't understand that there is this terrific being came on earth to help us? As if she didn't understand, or She had no patience, so she was acting as if she has no patience, and there is a reason why I'm saying this. And she had to convince everybody that Meherabad is the avatar of the age. When we walking in the street of Jerusalem, she would tell people in the street. We were walking in the markets of old Jerusalem. She would tell them, passers-by, and she would walk to the shop and give Baba cards and tell them this is the avatar of the age. She had no problem whatsoever about this. Screaming all over Jerusalem, Meherabad is the avatar of the age, and she was being considered as a lunatic by her family and friends. Boycotted from the world. She was living in a married to an Orthodox Jew, a very high scholar, one of those ancient scholars with 4 PhDs, and who speaks 6-8 languages like mother tongue, and he was a Hebrew expert, etc. And I spent lots of time with him during the 70s. And they told me that Meherabad is the outstanding personality, but in Judaism or some of it, they cannot take the notion of the descent of God on earth, and this is kind of even a blasphemy. And of course this is not true. When you go deep into the prophets and the what behind it, this is absolutely not true. But it's difficult to comprehend. It's actually, I think it's very convenient to say, and I spoke once with a very prominent rabbi, one of the greatest rabbis today in Israel, and he said, there's no way of achieving perfection in the physical realm. And this actually feels to me like a little excuse, trying to find an excuse that we cannot achieve this. Of course, we cannot achieve it because it can be achieved by the grace of a perfect master. And it's difficult for great, even great scholars to admit that perfection is possible on the physical realm. For shape perfection is something to be in the future when we will pass away, and kind God will let us be living in a perfect heaven. That's kind of perfection they're hoping to be. And this is not what we understand as perfection. Anyway, I just imagine the story, you know, and what I started to say before, that actually 76 to 79, actually I stayed away from her because I was deeply concerned not to get on odds with her, or I might say a word, because I had a deep, deep reverence for her. Baba, as if put a spell on me, so I will not dare to say anything whatsoever that will hurt her feelings. That is kind of it. And I would do it to other people, but not to her. With her, I've never done anything that will hurt her feelings. Not a single word, not a single utterance whatsoever. And it's not because, and it was not possible, if he would know your nature, that it is, this is because Baba put a spell on me, and I couldn't do this. And I didn't see, I was so particular about this, so I actually was not hardly seeing her 3 years before 79, because I was deeply concerned not to, let's say, disobey what Baba placed on my head in a way of revering his caring, which mundane sense there was no point whatsoever, because she was just an ordinary, finite, limited human being. And by some Baba coincidence, it's a wonderful story which I don't remember the accurate details, I came back to renew my contact with her. It's quite one of those incredible Baba stories, but I didn't keep the record, don't remember exactly. I think there was an article in newspaper or something like this about the passing of her husband. And I never read these pages in the newspaper. And what had happened, I think, I'm not sure about this, that I opened the newspaper where the people just started to read the page where people being mentioned they passed away. I never do such things. I don't concern about the people passing away also those days. I saw it as a happy occurrence. Even already since the 70s, people pass away. So they pass away. What's the big deal about it? It's actually, it's a cause for celebration. But what happened, I saw that the husband, Hillel Ben Shammai, passed away. So I said, well, I should go and pay my respects. At least go say, deliver my condolences to Carrie. Of course. I was seeing her every once in a while, seldom, and then I would just come, say hello, and this and that, and go away. Before she will start, you know, forcing Baba on me. And I came back to her, and what happened, I came to cheer up during the days after the passing of her husband, and she was trying to cheer up. And then she saw the dress. I don't remember exactly how it worked out, and she wanted to take her to India last time, which I did, of course. And it was quite a story, the whole ordeal, dealing with her. What she was doing, especially to me, I don't know. I have no idea. Anyway, it was, in retrospect, great fun. And a very, very testing period.
Did her husband believe in Baba?
Her husband told me that Meher Baba is, and I said it before, is an unusual personality. He's a giant, a spiritual giant. And he was the one who first did the translation of the discourses. And he translated a few discourses as a scholar with the ancient, a very kind of ancient poetic Hebrew style, which is not suitable to our modern times, but most likely a very scholarly Hebrew. And it was published during 1964, and won first prize in a book fair or something like this, and a copy was sent to Baba, and Baba was very, very pleased about the book, and signed the book, and he sent back the signed book to Israel. This particular book was vanished, we never found it. We don't know what happened. And he did quite a portion of the Hebrew discourses. Baba's discourses did the translation, some of it, or maybe most of it, into Hebrew. And when we came back from India, she couldn't walk anymore, and she had to be transferred to a home, and then she had to give the Baba room to me. All her treasures, everything. And it was quite unbelievable how she was sitting there and fondling all her Baba things. She had a full room with all kinds of all the ancient books, books from the 20s, or from the very beginning, first originals she was giving, and presumed by the Baba lovers, but then Baba lovers from America, and she was given books by Adi, and all kinds of things came there, and personal Baba material, which we still hold there. And she had to give all this to some young person. She even didn't know if he's a real professional Baba lover. you can imagine the Baba humor behind all this. Because, of course, Baba knew my heart, but she didn't. Well, that's the way Baba was playing the game, because it was quite a game. And she had to give me the center and all her things. And for days on, before she gave it to me, days or weeks, she gave me particular instructions for every one single piece of paper. Everything was neatly folded and covered with plastic so it won't get damaged and this and that. And on it went, instructions on instructions and instructions on what to do about this particular book and what is to do about this particular shelf. And then she had to be, eventually, she had to leave the house because actually all year I was attending to her every day, twice a day. I would go and buy her food. And I don't know what this great family she had. And she had a foster son from her husband. Her husband had a son, and she adopted him, actually, of course, and treated him like a son. And I hardly saw him during this period, the whole year, which I was coming and looking after her every day, buying her food in the morning and the evening, attending to her needs or whatever she wanted. which was amazing Baba stories. Every little thing is amazing Baba story. For example, her kettle got broken one day.
Her what?
Her kettle. You know what is a kettle?
Yeah.
It's some kind of a little instrument made of tin or something similar, of a metallic something. You put water inside and you put it on a fire. You boil water and you make tea. That's quite simple. Not to be scary. I went to the market and I bought a kettle. No, she said, this is not a kettle. I don't like this kettle. It is this and this and this and this. It's all big things. Of course, you could have boiled water, but it's no good. Then I went again to the market and I bought another kettle. A different shape, a different color, and different. It looks different. I came at her, she was totally disappointed. It's very bad. That's not a kettle at all. This is, you don't understand anything. That's not the way you work for Baba. And the scolding is abusive. Abusive, it was unbelievable. I went again, I bought a kettle. A kettle. Of course, it was not a good kettle, because what is a perfect kettle? You know, this is all, and it was on and on like this for every little issue. Drilling a hole in the wall just to hang a frame or whatever. Well, it's an inch too high, it's inch too low. Always something wrong with what I was doing. Nothing is good whatsoever. Always had to be extremely patient, all the time smiling, very happy. How fortunate I am to save it. One of Baba's mother. I didn't know, of course, she was Baba's mother. She was just a human being for me. And I wasn't concerned about this, but I felt Baba's wave on my brain. You dare not to serve my curry. You dare. As if there was something behind it, I could feel his, Baba's concern behind it. I should do everything she wants, accurately, at least to try at least. And of course, I always failed. There was no way of making her happy. I don't remember that I did anything whatsoever, which pleased her. I said, wow, that's exactly what I wanted. There never was such a thing. It was always some mistake. There was always something wrong. It was not perfectly perfect. There was this kind of infinite perfection about anything, as she demanded. And I could never meet it. But it was wonderful training, all right, for later on. Most of it she was dealing subconsciously. Baba was acting through her, teaching me some most profound lessons, which later on proved out to be most necessary while I was working for him. And she gave me a center, and I came to get her things and her son mother, and he gave me 15 minutes to pack and go. You just imagine the joke. We were going on for weeks on the preparations, how to pack and what to do and this and that. He told me, you have 15 minutes to get everything out. If not, I'm throwing everything out of the window. All the Baba treasures. He gave me 15, 20 minutes just to get out of the hell of it. That was all this abominable guru professing to be God. This is most Judaism. This is blasphemy. Most religion blasphemy. But they're completely wrong. This is not. It's not against the law of Moses. Not against the prophets. The prophets are talking about the manifestation of Godhood, etc. But we're not going to get into it. It's in between the lines. You need to know how to read it. But it is just part of this humanity trying to, it's shoving off spiritual responsibility. That's what I say. That's my humble understanding these days, at least. So I took the center, and you know, I had this kind of steel spell from the very beginning that I have to do something for humanity, and you know, I never felt anything that, you know, I never felt like any public figure. I was a simple human being living, trying to make a living somehow, and never felt any destiny about anything. I just wanted to stay. Actually, didn't want to take the center on me at all. And I don't mind saying it, but when came the time that I had to take the center, I felt it. Then I said, Baba, I'm not going to do this. I don't want any centers. Just I want to work with you silently, anonymously. I don't want anyone to hear my name. And you, what's going to be? You'll become some public figure. The center of Jerusalem goes to me, and I will have to become a kind of, in the Baba world, they will have to know my name. I didn't want anyone to know my name. I wanted to do my son work for him. I was doing all kinds of things quietly so nobody would know. whatever that was. And then the same came. And I was telling Baba inside. I know they already had longer, many years of training with Baba. He gave me a really good one during the 70s. I cannot get into it. This first of all, long story, and it might be confusing. And really gave me a very intense time. Obeying the impulse would come, and I would obey it, and things would go, and I wouldn't get into it. I had a very close communion with Baba, and I would tell him, I want this, I don't want to do this, and then I would get quick answers. You can imagine what answers I would get. In this instance, I'm telling you, I'm not going to do this. I can keep on serving Carrie, and buy food twice a day, and no problem whatsoever. That's okay. And Baba didn't say anything, supposedly. I didn't get any reverberations like what I was getting in the sense of being most respected to Carrie and others, other instances. I could feel the wave would come, just be alert. I would get it inside. As if Baba didn't say anything. He left me alone for my merits, so to say. And Dr. Sun is looking for a suitable home for her. Something at least reasonable, respectable. So far, she is a daughter of the Jewish Pope. You cannot put her some dump somewhere. You cannot. He didn't have much reverence for her. I don't think he treated her much like a mother. But he respected his father, and he was doing his best to find a respectable home for her, and he couldn't do this. And 3 weeks went by like this. He was running all over the country, this poor guy, and I'm continuing to attend to care. And inside I'm telling Baba, I'm not doing it. They don't know me. As long as I'm not going to accept it, he is not going to find a home for her. He dawned on me and said, well, this, and I looked at it, all she turned and said, well, what's like, what is going to be? I said, well, okay, I'm taking it. I'll do it. As soon as I'll do it, immediately he found a home. Immediately the Baba Center came. In 3 days, the whole thing was over. She went to her home. I got the Baba Center. The whole thing just resolved in just like this. It was quite amazing. And I had many Baba stories which happened like this, and of course this made me understand that what Baba really wants, and in this sense he was compassionate, and he didn't order me to do this, he left me, of course I wanted to serve him and work for him, but I didn't want to do anything in a public sense, just wanted to be, to stay incognito, and he didn't want this. So, because I served him, I was willing to take this pain of serving the public. So, what to do for the public? I was not much of a speaker, not much of a society person. People were not coming to see me at all. I was a total loner, and I was totally alone. Alone within the world, just a little bit of family, or some as a madman, and some by wasting his lifespan, some weird thing, and this and that. So I didn't know what to do, so I started to say, well, what shall I do? So I already had some considerably English command, so I started to do Baba translations. So I started to translate a Baba book. And the first Baba book I translated was Sobs and Throbs. I got, I was looking in the archives which I got from Curry, and found this, the very original from the 20s, and it translated into Hebrew. And in this particular booklet, I didn't translate the whole thing, I concentrated on the figure of Ali as a demonstration of the perfect student and disciple who goes all the way through for his master, etc. And I felt that this is a good book for the youth of Israel. So I was thinking. And I went ahead and published the book and this and that, and I had 1,000 copies of this little booklet, which still have maybe 100 or 200 copies left. Then I was wondering to myself, what shall I do with this book? Okay, I have these piles of printed material, what to do with it? I really had no one to talk to about Meherabad besides Carrie those days. So I got this idea, might as well, if I have all this pile of books, I'll donate a few books to the arborist in Israel. So I went to the Minister of Education and I said, as I was told, they are in charge of public libraries. So I went to some office dealing with the public libraries and asked them, do you want this book? I printed the book and the person, I told them this way, I told them that the publisher would like to contribute a copy or two copies for each library. That's the way I said it. As if I'm not the publisher. And they said, okay, leave us a copy, and I look at it and decide if it's worthwhile for distribution. So I left them a copy and I came back after a week and they said, well, we think it's worthwhile, but we're not doing a distribution, you can do it by yourself. If so you wish, on your expense. So they gave me a list of the whole libraries in Israel, mainly, there were many high schools and all kinds of places, whatever. So I took the whole list, whole long list, it was a book, hundreds of libraries.
Wow.
Maybe 100 or 200 libraries all over Israel. And I hired a girl, a secretary, to pack our books, two copies, each library, pack it, stamp it, mail. She was working all month at least on this. So I sent the Baba book, all the libraries, and I felt very good about this. And of course, many were returned, that they don't like it, and some of them were dumped out and were giving away, as usually, as it happens, and I sent some of it to bookstores, etc. And this book eventually brought about a few people to Baba. At least Michal Sivan, who comes here often, found this book in a used bookstore, second-hand bookstore, and it cost 25 cents, I think, or half a cent, or half a dollar, they wanted for 25 cents, they wanted for the little book, and she was going to India, and she didn't know why and what and where to go, and she went to a used bookstore and looking for some material to read on the way, and she found this little Baba book, accidentally, of course. She didn't know anything about Baba, all right, and she found this little book, and in the end of the book, there was my address, and she sent me a registered letter that she needs some directives how to get her. So of course I contacted her, it was just before she left, and I gave her instructions or whatever I knew how to get to Meherabad and about the mandali. I think I told her to send a letter to Herod, and I think she even got a response. Just before she left with some directive, I don't remember what, doesn't matter. And she told me when she opened the book, she took the book from the bookstore and she boarded the bus to home. And she opened the book and the world vanished. And she didn't know where she is. And she was totally absorbed and she was totally taken aback by this booklet or whatever Baba did to her, I don't know. So she is... in this instance, at least, she became very closely associated with MeherBabaLibrary. And you know, as you know, she came here many times, etc. And I know later on people told me that they were deeply touched by this little book, etc. And kept on doing it since then, all kinds of translations. And then came the day I started to do the translation of the Hebrew discourses, which is a whole long Baba story. And Carrie was still alive. It was 1983. Before that, I did a book of my own words. I had this deep compulsion inside me that I have to bring in very essence of what is the truth and what's the purpose of life and the story, the spiritual story of the evolution of mankind. And it was a kind of summary of God's speaks and other statements of Baba. But in this little book, for whatever reason, I didn't make any mention of Baba's name. I just placed his picture there.
You have a picture of Baba in it?
There is a Baba picture in it with the name of the first avatar. The first avatar was Adam. I don't know why I did it and from where I got it. But a few months later came the book of Baoji. The nothing is everything, or the everything is the nothing. Well, there is saying that Adam was the first avatar. So I really don't know from where all the whole thing came. And then it felt good to me. And quite. But what was the? It was excellent preparation for the translation of the discourses, because it demanded this production. It was a small booklet. Tremendous amount of study in English, because I wrote it firstly in Hebrew, which is my mother tongue, of course. And then after I read it and looked at it for a while, I realized that definitely in Israel there will not be any market for it. And much as well, I'll rewrite it in English. Maybe somebody will read it abroad, which of course never happened. But it was the most massive year of study and training. I looked through editors to work on the material, because I always, when I published the Baba book, I was hiring professionals to look through the material to make sure that my Hebrew is correct and translation is correct. That's the way we should do Baba work, as I was trained. That should be not a single work of one person, but there should be like a few people working on it, just to make sure that it's appropriate, correct, less mistakes, etc. And also the cooperation, also the people are working together on Baba project. That was one of my first Baba lessons in the very beginning. A spiritual work we should do as a group. And the editors I found for this booklet simply couldn't copy this. One of them was a translator of that prominent rabbi whom I spoke before. One of the, he's a real genius, remarkable human being. And I had the closest association with this translator, and he looked. He worked on my work, and when I saw what he's doing with it, I realized that he won't get into the core of things, he won't, he couldn't get and work out the spiritual essences of what I was trying to bring to focus. So eventually I got into some, presumably, it was said, some English professor, and she said she was writing scripts for Hollywood or something like this. Person immigrated to Israel from the United States, and she was teaching me English quite intensely for 4 years after that. So this Baba project actually gave me quite an intense study in English, till she started to teach me in a writing class. We started to write novels and such things in English. And then I realized that this time came to an end. 4 years of weekly studies, quite intense studies in English, etc., etc., just to polish the English and bring it to shape, etc. Then, after I finished this project, it was in 1993, the whole year I was working on 30 pages. You can imagine the energy went into it. With four editors, one for the Hebrew and three for the English.
This was that little booklet?
Yeah, that was just this little book. I have it. I even sent it to the Mandalay, it was 1984. I sent it to Meherabad. That was not the issue, what I did with it. It was a massive preparation for the translation of the discourse, as this I understood later on, because what I have studied there was essential for this project. Then Carrie was keep on saying that we have to use material of her husband, and publish it as a translation of the Hebrew discourse. And I read it, and I gave it to my editor those days, and what he thinks about the material, and we had the same conclusion that Hebrew is out of date, it's too high for the Hebrew reader, it's too scholarly, the language was very academic and difficult. Hebrew is a very, very old language. Records go 4,000 years old, and we have many, many layers of Hebrew, and each age is a different language. There are languages within languages within languages, and the modern Hebrew is totally different. For example, from the 19th century Hebrew, and Hebrew was 19th century Hebrew, which is a modern Hebrew reader would find it impossible to read almost. So I was looking at the material, and at one particular point I told Carrie, you know that Hillel, that was the name of her husband, he did it for himself, and I put it aside. It was his, he did it for his own spiritual purpose. And I actually didn't tell her that I'm not, I didn't use it, I hardly used it. I looked at it here and there, and I started the whole thing from the very beginning. And this is a difficult, high mental work, and this and that. And I prefer to do what I did before, you know, Baba stories like Soaps and Throats, Story of Ali, such things. It's more my cup of tea. Entertaining, you know, you bring it, all kinds of Baba things, and all kinds of stories and anecdotes. And this is to go and to do this difficult intellectual project. And I started working on it, and you know, I said to Baba, you know, I don't like doing it. I don't know why sometimes I'm doing such things. Don't misinterpret, don't want to serve my Lord. I want to serve my Lord very much. You simply have no idea how much I'm willing to go for it. There was no question at all if you think that I refuse to take the center or this and that, that I don't want to serve my Lord or don't want to have the hesitations, whatever, or... That's part of, you know, this kind of interaction between the Lord and one of his children, you know, what we are. We are little children. And sometimes he would give me this leeway of playing my little game. Often he wouldn't give me any leeway whatsoever. Sometimes, many times, there were issues to be dealt with. Then I knew the impulse would come. You better take it off. There and then, you know, leeway whatsoever. I'm not going to bet into it. What was and what was not. Doesn't matter. So I was trying to say, and it was not working out. And I told the story in the fragment in my story about Ben Shammai, how the translation came worked out. So I thought, oh, I'm not going to do this because I was getting tired of this. I wanted to do something else. So I got the impulse first. When I said this thing to Baba, inside, I felt that he was extremely displeased, very, very, very displeased. When Baba, my Lord, is very displeased, it's like a fire coming for him, and it's hell on earth. For me to displease Baba is war for him. So I was actually being submerged in this hell state towards him. And then in this kind of hell state, you know, it was just for a little while, all in fire, all in flame, you know. Lord is displeased, this wave of displeasure is coming, it's totally shattering. If you experience such a thing, you would know what I'm saying. Then I'm thinking to myself, this is kind of really crazy, why should I displease my Lord? I want to walk in heaven. That's what you want, that's what, more or less what I need to do. Then when I came to my senses, as if Baba said, you just translate three words a day. That's the inner voice. Three words a day you can translate as it is, literally. It doesn't matter if it's good or bad. I was thinking to myself, this is kind of, you know, I was very polite, you know. He's God, and that's, I'm just a small little me, and I'm obeying the orders, and I'm started doing it, 3 watts a day. Every morning I was getting up, 3 watts, and off I would go, no, and that's it. 3 watts every day, one after another. And he just see his wisdom and compassion, this kind of little answer. I started to gear in, and this story, particular story, was going on for 4 years, every day. Every day, if I wouldn't get up, if I wouldn't do it, these 3 words a day, that particular day, I would go to her, to the Baba, as I would tell you. Well, we get this deep, this wave of displeasure from the road, and it blew my mind. So what I was doing, just to escape this wave of displeasure, so funny. I was doing first thing in the morning, these 3 words, and I would, and that's not all what he wanted me to do, and I would do my things during the day.
Done for the day.
Done for the day, Baba is happy, I did my 3 words a day. You know, it's so childish when you look at it in retrospect, but we are little children, so he's toying around with us, but there is deep psychology behind all the thing. Eventually I developed a habit, and the 3 words turned into 3 sentences a day. And even one day, I can say the whole full page, one day, you wouldn't believe this. And 4 years have passed, and I finished the whole discourse. This way, 3 words a day, you wouldn't believe it. I said, this is insane. This is not going to be accomplished forever. It was accomplished after 4 years. And what's happening after 4 years? What I'm doing, what I was trained before with my former publications, I had to rewrite everything. Now, after I did, I would do a translation. And the joke of the whole thing is the very first translation, Baba was, I didn't know what to do. Baba was as if I was locked in my apartment for 2 weeks. In 2 weeks' time, I did a whole translation of a Baba book. That was MeherBaba on roof. In 2 weeks' time, I translated the whole thing. It was a mind blower. I think I didn't sleep for 2 weeks. No stop, around the clock, no stop translation. And I thought, to quite naively, that this is going to be like this all the time. This wonderful Baba experience, this fantastic, you know how it goes. And then I got this endless tedious work, slowly, endlessly, which you don't see the end. You can see that how Baba is working is our psychology. First, I got this amazing experience that I can actually do a translation. So in 2 weeks he made me translate the whole Bible book because I didn't know what to do. So he put the spell on me, presumably, and then I was just translating non-stop around the clock, day and night.
That was a bad decision.
Yeah, when Baba wants, yes, I know. When Baba wants you to do something, it is being done, and that's it. But here, it was different, and it was working naturally. And 4 years have passed, and what I was doing with the former translation, now I took the whole thing, started to rewrite everything, so to make the sentences flowing. And what happened? That the new edition of the discourses came up. So I started to do the translation all over again. Because the new version came, and Don Stevens told me that I should rely on the new version. So I took the new version. So what happened? I was looking at the old version and the new version, and doing a second translation from the very beginning, I was retranslating the whole book. And this, now I got the mood, took only 2 years. And then after I accomplished the thing, and I did again what being required, what I was trained, I took the materials and wrote it again in Hebrew without looking at the source, it's English, to turn it into flowing Hebrew sentences, because it was not a flowing Hebrew. Because when you translate as is, even it was a second translation, because the second translation, I was looking at the first translation, I was looking at the three volume English and the one volume English. I was comparing all these three all the time and doing a new translation in Hebrew according to the, and also I had the five volume, I still have the five volume discourses, so sometimes I was looking at them. But mainly that was the process. The second phase was going like this every day. I was looking at the three sources and rewrite a new version. And this took 2 years, and when I finished these 2 years, now 6 years have passed. Yeah, 6 years have passed. And now I took the new translation and started to rewrite it in flowing Hebrew. I wrote it in flowing Hebrew without looking at the original source, and this took another 2 years. 8 years have passed. Every day walking on Baba's work, if I wouldn't dare to do the three words, it doesn't matter. This kind of so-called order, it persisted. If I wouldn't do a day walk, that was hell, and that's it. Non-stop, every day, get up in the morning, walk for 1 minute for Baba. Every day I would start like this, every day. You just imagine what was going on with this. And I was not such a kind or disciplined person at all. I wouldn't do this otherwise. And after 8 years, 8 years have passed. Carrie passed away in 1986. We didn't see the translation of the discourse, even not the first version. To add the joke, the Baba joke, between what Baba was playing his joke with me and Carrie not telling her that Baba is the arbiter. And then I found later on, Max Siebert sent me his communications with Carrie and they're working, etc. And Carrie was writing a letter to Max, 1984. Etzion Becker has improved for the better, something like this. It started to be a good Baba Lover or something like this, at last, after 14 years. Still, I didn't tell her. I mean, of course, I didn't know this letter. And I never told her that I knew the MeherBaba's avatar, even till she passed away. And now the joke of the whole thing is, and of course, if I go back a little bit to Carrie, and she was getting ill, her body was falling apart. And I'm talking about from 1979, 1980, she was confined to a wheelchair. She was a dancer. You can imagine what a hectic person. She was like a walking flame. She was a walking flame, buzzing around all the time. And she was talking nonstop. She couldn't shut her mouth for a minute. Not a minute. All the time she was talking. Whatever. I mean, something like this. Amazing. All the time. Nonstop. She was buzzing nonstop. Unbelievable. And she had this kind of sickness. I'm not saying in a way of denouncing her. God forgive me about this. It was just almost this kind of nature. She was a Jalali, or I don't know what she was. Don't ask me about this. I don't proclaim to understand this thing. She was a walking fire. And of course, she was confined to, just imagine, such a person being confined to a wheelchair for seven long years. And she was crying all the time. Oh, wow, Baba could do such a thing to me. Oh, Baba could. She was complaining all the time and whining and complaining, all the time behaving in the most non-spiritual way possible. And I was very quiet, very silent. I just kind of, all the time, Baba spread as if I could see Baba walk, looking behind my shoulder. You behave, huh? You don't dare to do anything whatsoever to insult my character. All the time I could see this glance behind my shoulder. So all the time I was extremely respectful. If it would be up to me, I have quite a sharp tongue. I can say something. If you will get on odds with me, it might be a possibility you'll get a very unhappy answer and say, you don't want to do this. In those days, if you would tell me something, I would give you quite an answer, which you wouldn't love to hear it. And with her, exceptions have never uttered a word, not once, for 14 years. And it was just because of this Baba spell. Otherwise, I wouldn't be able to abide by this. And I saw her just before she passed away, a couple of months, 2 months, 3 months, something like this before she passed away. I used to pass by and visit her in the home, and her case was deteriorating. And she had some kind of strange sickness. She was dying. Her body was dying from the toes, legs, up, falling asleep. Slowly, you could see it. Something was falling asleep all the way up. I don't know what it is. I never saw the medical report. I was not told, and I didn't ask, and I don't think they would tell me. I have no idea what it is. Very strange. So the last time, she couldn't speak. You couldn't understand a word of what she is saying. And she was not here already. This was kind of, it was all veiled. And I don't remember how the conversation, but there was, you know, we were exchanging words, but, you know, there was already hardly any human being on the other side to communicate, but I was talking to her. You see, even if you go to, you visit a person who is in a coma, you talk to him. She was not in a coma, she was responding, she was talking. And for whatever reason, we started talking Baba. When the word Baba came, and the issue came Baba, all of a sudden, the veil was rented, and she was her own self. And this is, and she was perfectly clear, perfectly right on, and I was totally amazed. I was just speechless. And presumably, what I saw, a being. I saw something. I don't know what. I'm not a psychic. I'm not a spiritual person. I don't know what I saw. I saw a being, presumably. I don't know what was this being. It was one of Baba's angels. I saw an angel, presumably. I don't know what I saw. And presumably, Baba had good luck at my expense. I was ahead all the time, all in all. That was his game. He was playing a game on me, so okay. Good game. Good lesson. That may really good one. And now if you have a little bit back to the discourses, 8 years have passed. Now, according to the instruction from the trust and Don Stevens side to hire an expert to go over the translation, make sure that he did a good job, of course. Otherwise, don't accept it. Very particular. John Stevens, the money I was dealing with, the trust, and all the people. Saying this particular project, it was not easy, of course. All the people are, you know, Baba people, Baba Mandali, very tough figures, all of them. Or each one of them a challenge to get by. Each one is in. You have to discover the unique psychology of dealing with each one of them, the unique psychology of money, the unique psychology of Don Stevens, etc. All the time challenges, wonderful people, wonderful challenges. I'm most a grateful person who was giving this opportunity dealing with such people, who were trained personally by Baba himself. Wonderful training. Often most challenging and heartbreaking and mind-wrenching, etc., etc., but if you go all the way through, very rewarding. And I was going back to my, just trying to find somebody to do this work, and I got this astonishing figures, like $11,000, just to compare between the English and the Hebrew, just to compare it. Of course, I didn't have $10 to put. Nothing. I didn't have any money at all to spend on it. And the situation also quite bad in Israel. You know, there was the beginning of the Saddam Hussein was threatening Israel, and there was this coming imminent first Gulf War coming. It was quite a serious depression. Israel depends on tourism, export. All situation was very bad, and actually was unemployed. Didn't find work, and I think my wife was fired from work, which stopped coming to Israel. It became a dangerous war zone, etc. But yes, Baba's work is standing there and has to be continued, come what may. That's his work, and I already was in the mood, and I was not waiting for his prodding anymore. I was just doing it. So I came to my former editor and asked him, what can we do about this? So eventually we agreed on $5,000, which was an enormous sum. Those days, 1990, especially if you consider that it don't have worked. So I told him, keep on doing it, do one chapter a month, $70 a month, we have 70 chapters about. And I was kind of joking, you know what, maybe instead of paying you, I'll build you a room or make the decoration or something in the house. Because I'm doing renovations and carpeting and all these things, people need it. And in the contract we wrote that half of the money will be paid by work. And now I remember, half of the money I was supposed to do by work because I have a big house and they need all the time things to do, like paint jobs or building a cabinet or fixing something, I don't know. So we started doing it and the war broke out and it was very bad, etc. To my remembrance, that was the time of the war, I think. Well, after the war, it doesn't matter, it definitely was during the year of the war and it was very, very serious situation, it was very bad. And it was working 3 months and I didn't paint 3 months. And for my, I could have scratched $70. It is not that we were living in the street and didn't have anything to eat. This was not, never was so bad. But it was tight and this was like extra. But I didn't want to, I said, let's start the Baba work and then let's see what Baba is going to do. If he'll provide, we'll continue. If he doesn't provide, then he doesn't provide. Then he doesn't want it. That was my attitude. Then after 3 months, one day he called me and my editor, and he did already the first three chapters, of course. He was doing a chapter a month. So he took me down to the basement behind the house and he said, you see, we have this dugout under the house. The house was standing on a hill and here this is a slope. And under the house, there was a dugout, like it was like a huge empty hole under the house, unbuilt, unfinished. And he asked me, can you finish this and turn it into an apartment? And this was like a 90 square meter wall. Like building a whole big apartment out of the... I just got a skeleton of columns and concrete. And, you know, we were dealing, wheeling and dealing and arguing and this and that. I eventually came to some compromise and I started to do the work, which was about $60,000 work, I believe. Then I started to work. So what happened? The neighbors also wanted also work. So I got the neighbor, there were four neighbors, one next to each other. So then the next neighbor also ordered this project to do the same renovation. So I got two flats to renovate, to rebuild. Altogether, for sure, more than $100,000 per. And the third one wanted an addition, and this one wanted, and I was very busy for more than 6 months. So what happens that in a few months, Baba paid, it was Baba paid the whole full $5,000 right away. Because as soon as we made the agreement, we removed $5,000 for work. And I got more money. And I was just, it was very incredible situation. It was just a real relief from the whole situation. So I was working and we had some money and even took some money, went to Mirror Center, so it was wonderful. And then we finished the whole thing and he had to keep on working for 2 more years to finish his editing process. And then he came to send a few chapters, I think, to John Stevens and he gave it okay. And today the discourses are available. I did. For whatever reason, I didn't finish it printing completely, even I'm permitted to do so on behalf of the John Stevens, on behalf of the trust. The people can receive it as I give it to them and they ask as an A4 for me. I guess one day I'll publish it as a proper book. What I did meanwhile, felt like I did quite a few more translations besides this. Eventually I printed the Meherabad on wall, which Mani didn't like in the beginning. She said, we don't like to start with the Book of Wall, so she canceled the project, and I did Sobs and Thorps instead, and I translated, I don't remember even how many, quite a few books. Like Sababa the Perfect Master, Much Silence, Merwan's Stories for Children. I do, that's how it was, Stories by Urge. I started to do recently the book published, I think, by the Sufis on the drugs, the new books, After God in Appeal or something like this. And I think there are a few more titles, I really don't remember all of them. And if public wants, we'll continue doing it.
You now have a website, right? Israel now has a website for
Yeah, we have a small, humble website.
And what's it called?
MeherBabaLibrary.org, under the custody of, I don't know. We place it Trustmare. We were given a good deal by Trustmare. So
someone can go into it
and see the power project, what we did.
Meherbaba Israel.
Meherbaba Israel, some. It appears on the main Baba site, meherbaba.org, I think. Which.
Jai Meher, or the one that.
Not about Jesus, I think the main Baba Sahib, which runs by Eric Solibaki, if I'm not wrong. This one. It appears on the list of the Baba Sahibs. Well, I don't know. I will continue with this, maybe not, I have no idea. We have the, all kinds of Baba photos and what we were doing. But besides this, of course, there are many other people who would come to Meherabad, and Israelis who heard about, many people heard about Meherabad in Israel over the years from other sources. The New Age movement started to catch up during the mid-80s and the early 90s especially. And Meherabad appears in many books and pamphlets all over the world as one of the masters and spiritual figures of the time, so many people heard about him. Articles appeared about him in various Hebrew magazines. I have no idea how people came to hear about him. And quite a few figures, spiritual figures in Israel, heard about him already from the 70s, so he's known amongst their spiritual circles. Heard about him quite many. But
you know, how many are there different Baba centers in Israel? Do you know there?
I have no idea. I don't pose like any Baba center. I'm a private individual. I have the library Kerev and Shammai gave me, and enlarged the library over the years. I used to buy Baba books, trying to make it updated, and besides the translations and other things. And there are all kinds of individuals who do whatever they do according to their understanding. They get together in different cities. Sometimes we meet quite seldom. Some of the groups get together. I have no idea. It's usually in the coast. I personally don't know much about all this. I have no idea. You maybe know more than I know. Yeah. And it is just a nutshell of it. So it's real fun. Actually, today, I'm going Baba Stroy. You know, we have a group of non-Israelis here today.
Yeah.
They came. And they came. This is actually an amazing Baba Stroy, because what happened 6 years ago? See how Baba works. You want more say Baba, another Baba Stroy? Thousands of wonderful Baba Stroys. Baba is absolutely... He's a... A person who moves to Baba is willing to take the risk and the odds of obeying him, and surrendering to him, accepting Happily, it displeases because we're humans and we make mistakes, and we have to accept it because he wants us to come to the point of perfection. That was the training I got from Carrie. And what happened, I was doing the translation, I got quite happy about, you know, when I finished the discourses, I said, what I'm going, I didn't tell the story, well, what happened to me? I told him in the beginning, the Baba signed a Baba book, and he got lost, the first Israeli Baba book in Hebrew. Then Carrie gives me a center, and we really turned our house upside down to find the book everywhere. In the storage, we looked everywhere, and we couldn't find the signed Baba book. You know, Baba signed it, God's signature. Where is it? Where is the signature of God? And we didn't know where is it. It went wherever it went. We don't know it. So, I finished all discourses, the whole thing came to an end, 10 years of daily work. These 10 years, maybe no more than 3-4 days, maybe, I didn't do work for it. 10 years, we just figured out, 3,650 days, and maybe I didn't do 2-4 days maximum, and I think one day I didn't want to do it, and maybe 2-3 days I went to the army, I didn't have time to do it. I was on army reserves, and there were all the time going back and forth. I was a field fighter in the infantry, doing my duties for the country and all this. Sometimes it was hard to do, but it's not to be excused anyway, but you can figure it out. It is not because of my own power, dear. Anyway, I finished the Baba project, the discourses after 10 years, and then I was looking at the Baba library. Do you want to stop them?
No.
And I was looking at the Baba library, and many books I've never opened before, never seen them before. You like the noise of the background, make it more authentic. And there was this book sitting there, Stay With God, and I took it from between the books. I've never touched it before, never looked at it before. And I was opening the book, it started to leaf. And I was looking at the book, one of the pages, and this kind of a scribble though. I was looking at it. I was looking at the scribble, what is this? What's written? The M.S. Irani? Is this M.S. Irani? Well, what is this M.S. Irani thing? What is it? Is this Baba's signature? So I went and looked into my all kinds of documents. I was, you can imagine, just imagine what I was thinking, feeling about this. And somewhere I found a photo of Baba's signature, and this was, of course, Baba's signature. As if, and you can see,
and
yeah, I know afterwards I learned that he did sign a few of them, but you see the coincidence. And I was telling Baba, I said, myself, how can you be so cool? Hide this for 14 years? It was only 1992, 12, 13 years since I got under my cousin the Baba's center. And I could have found it before that. Why after, and exactly when after I finished the translation, as if Baba gave his signature that he accepts it. It was so, you know, that, and I was telling Baba, how can you do such a thing? I could feel this little glimpse of kind of you, as if Baba was smiling under his nose, kind of, you know. He, that's his game, he likes to play with us, with all the, but could feel that he was very, very amused about the whole thing. Most likely, it was most amusing to see the expression of wonderment in my face, finding it. what does he want me to say? Yes, we spoke about the 9 Israelis who came here. Now what happened, I finished doing this kind of a project, and I did more projects, and years passed by, I was doing it really now, becoming more efficient and quick, doing all these things. So I think it was 99 or 2000. One day I inside myself tell Baba, you know, you're teaching me English all these years, and you teach me how to translate and do all these things. What about this that I'll become a professional translator, I'll do it for a living. I was still sending Baba. Well, 2 days later, I'm getting a phone call from Tel Aviv. There was this blind person, his name is Ronen Bas, and I used to have Baba meetings at his home in Tel Aviv during the 90s. He heard about Meher Baba and asked me to come and give meetings, mid-90s. We had a few meetings in Tel Aviv during the 90s, here and there. People whom I knew and wanted me to come over, so we had this little humble Baba meetings in Tel Aviv. And he calls me, this person, and said that Theosophical Society in Israel is looking for a translator to translate Blavatsky book, The Sacred Doctrine, into Hebrew. So what was it? Theosophical Society is, if you remember in the beginning, is actually the mother movement of Rudolf Steiner in a way, where I started my first steps in spirituality, which led me to Meher Baba. So I had this kind of feeling inside myself that I have some obligation, I have to give some respect to this movement. For me, it doesn't matter. I'm not differentiating theosophy and anthroposophy. For me, it's just the same. Anyway, it doesn't matter. There are different differences and differentiations, but these are human beings. I don't enter into it. And it was agreed. I called Mr. Abraham Oron, he is president of the Theosophical Society in Israel. You know, it's an organized group and with ranks and branches and this and that. I'm not going to get into it, it doesn't matter. And we have agreed that I'll do the project for some payment. Whatever that is, it's not the payment which was the issue. And I started doing this thing, and now here in Meherabad, I'm coming to the end of the project and coming to the end of the translation, more or less. And over the years, we developed some friendships, simple human friendships, and I was helping them as I would love to help any spiritual movement, serious spiritual movement. With Baba statements and with all kinds of things, which is a Dino before, like in the internet, etc., contributing articles. And it so happens that after all these years, and once a year, I understood they have a tour of India. They have the headquarters in Madras, in Adyar, and then they make a tour of the sites, spiritual sites of India, etc. And this year they wanted to come to Meherabad to find out who is this Meher Baba, whom they get articles and all kinds of little quotes which I keep on sending to them and, as well as others over the years, and which some of them they published in their news magazine and they press it on their websites as the as quotes of very spiritual masters. From time to time, they bring quotes of very spiritual masters as well as Meher Baba.
It's okay,
Okay, and they want to come to Meherabad, and now they are in Meherabad. Touring India, came to Meherabad. So it is. Another Baba story. Yeah. And what they are going to do with it, of course, I have no idea. It's up to them, up to the Lord, up to... this, I, of course, I have no idea, actually. What will be the next step? Yes, I actually coordinated it, so I will be able to help them a little bit in case they will meet with some difficulties. We plan it together. I came on purpose to make sure when they come here, so it will be properly received and accepted, you know. They're all human beings, and they make mistakes, and maybe they will have to make sure, I was sort of kind of, they were making sure that they stay in the PC, you know, these little things, but you know, you are here quite quite good with all this, and you are very reliable. You're doing a marvelous work, and they are deeply impressed with the simplicity, the beauty, and the cleanliness, and the quality of work we are doing here. And quite touched by what's happening. I think they heard some deep truths about Baba's mission, spirituality. Part of this, most of it, they already know, because Baba said he didn't come to teach but to awaken. They asked for about his philosophy, and Baba is not dealing with philosophy. They have enough philosophy. While doing the translation, I saw many times as if Baba put his hand in Blavatsky's work. She had two masters. And it's quite mysterious, the whole thing, the master. I'm not really sure about the whole thing. But because I'm so closely associated with MeherBaba and the other masters of Baba, you know that the phenomenon of masters is true. And they don't have it so obvious as we do have it. Because we really live next to a real living master and other masters. We really know it all. We have the real true experience. So, by the force of this experience, which I have heard over the years, with living so intimately with Baba, etc., I know, I could feel the way behind Blavatsky, as if she's part of the New Age. As we know, when she started to work, Sai Baba of Shirdi was acting as the head of the spiritual hierarchy, and nothing moves in the spiritual realm on earth and earth and beyond without his consent. He knows everything that we know well, approved by Baba and approved by the masters, and this is a little bit know how spiritually works. And it was about time to place the open truth on the table for humanity to come and take responsibility of the ancient truth that the Master keep on giving us over the past thousands of years, and it's about time to take spiritual responsibility and do something and not just talk about this and
but it is interesting how all these years of contact with them.
Yeah, they have decided I've never said anything to them. I've never said once, why don't you come to Meherabad? Why don't you? Are you interested? I've never. One of the things I was trained by Carrie, and this is an example I was giving by Carrie. That's the way Baba taught me not to do what Carrie was doing. That we should never ever force MeherBaba on anyone. Of course, he was using her to demonstrate something to me. And this of course in the beginning I didn't understand, this I'm telling you now. Now I know that he was teaching me something through her. She was his literally turned to him. He could have used her for a walk. This is what I'm telling from my deep personal understanding. She taught me in a way how not to do spiritual work, and this was like a mirror. I had to look inside myself and outside what is true spiritual work. And she was actually, Baba was sacrificing her for this. This is quite amazing.